Hey guys, and welcome to another Nerd in a Weeb Walks into a Bar. Today we have our group, and we are in Average Joe's. With me, I am your designated driver, Will.
And I'm your designated drinker, Glen. Today's new drink for me is going to be Bacardi. Let's go ahead and try it out.
As he tests this, we actually have two honored guests today. We have our friends, He Who Shall Not Be Named, and Ryan.
Yeah, I'm really excited to be here with Voldemort today.
I'm having my Monster Sticks, as you guys will probably learn throughout these podcasts. I only come from Monster Sticks, and to make sure Glenn doesn't like get lost. What are you eating, Ryan? As
a Detroit Lion Burger, and I'm halfway through my poutine already. It was very good.
Our friend who shall not be named is eating the Monster Sticks also. How are you enjoying them?
Yes.
You know, it's... And so how was your drink, Glenn? Your shot?
It's not bad. It's not a shot this time, unlike last time.
Yeah, last time wasn't a shot.
It's not bad. It's just actually rum and coke, which is not bad. And it's a Bacardi, so I enjoy it.
So I thought today's topic, we decided to kind of just talk. You might hear some noise of crippling and stuff. That's just the food. We're sorry ahead of advance time, but... As we get into this, we'll have better equipment, even lapels. You know, the microphone's like on your shirt.
So fancy.
Today's topic, because we already went over 9th edition, so we can get Ryan and friend's name, that shall not be named, their opinions on it. Then we're going to go into D&D stories, because there's a couple of new books coming out, and I know a lot of people have been wanting to do events.
Right.
And been playing online, so we can kind of catch up and stuff. So... What is your guys' opinions on 9th edition?
I hate it every time a new edition comes out because I just don't like buying new books. But, from what I've heard, they're gonna hopefully do 9th edition, giving it a focus on close combat. That's awesome. Right, that's something 40K has been lacking in forever, is a good close combat, or at least not nerfing those armies into the ground. We'll never get away from the gun line.
Glenn's doing the laughing. Oh, here comes his nachos.
Yay, finally the nachos.
Sorry, don't worry about
it. Don't worry about it. Oh, drink. I thought you said Drake.
Not even drunk yet. Oh, yeah.
Not yet, anyway.
Mm-hmm. So, Voldemort?
I'm remaining neutral about the whole...
9th edition?
Yeah, I don't know.
There's nothing enough. You're excited for? Nothing you're disappointed
I know about. Absolutely nothing about 9th edition, other than it's coming out.
Man, you know less than me. That's impressive.
There's some mean spoilers. Mainly, now, for Overwatching, you have to spend a command point.
We heard about
that's
that.
Probably
that's
the one thing I know about.
So, you guys know the command points. So, for the new one, if you have a patrol, you automatically get 3 command points. If you have a battalion, you automatically get 6. If you have a brigade, you automatically get 12. So it doesn't add to your current 3 than what you have.
What's the requirements for brigade again?
It's the same as 8.
No, but like brigade, practically apocalypse, 3 to 5.
Oh, that is actually just called apocalypse or something.
No, straight up.
I'm pretty sure brigade is...
It's onslaught.
Yeah.
Onslaught is... Hmm. Apocalypse. Yeah, so they took the detachments from 8th and the points you get from it and just made it like when you play a game you have to choose a point bracket like in Age of Sigmar and you get points based off. It's basically Age of Sigmar.
There's no 9th edition. Imperial Guard brigades I'm going to be going up against. That's not happening anymore?
You will get that to begin with because they want to keep like all the codexes they said were made in Mindwithai. There is a free update that's coming out, like as an app, that will update your armies to match it from day one.
You know what?
And I expect over time they will make new codexes to fix it, to update it.
Mm. Well, of course, they can't resist selling books.
Another spoiler that I saw today, fallback. Of course, everybody knows fallback for 40K. In the new edition, you use 2 command points. But before you fall back, you roll a d6 for each of your models. On any ones, they die.
Really?
Yeah.
Explosive vehicle bailout.
Then you fall back.
No
No, that kind of makes some sense, because as you're falling back, the enemy will still try to poke you.
Stab me in the back.
Yeah.
But, like, still, 2 command points? I would prefer it being free,
it's
to be
2
honest.
Command points to fall back? Oh, cool.
That'd be D6 for each of the mobs falling back or Horde army will suck.
That is nerfing gunline armies a lot.
Yeah. Rip Tau players.
Mm-hmm.
They're
all the memes for
Tau
players.
Yeah.
The Age of the
Tau
is done.
Oh, it's never done.
Yeah. That's a little recap on 9. Luminette is coming out. That's amazing.
Oh, yeah. Paria. Yeah. Which Warhammer TV did back on Sunday, that it's going to be a prologue for Indominus. So that's going to be interesting how it all began. With the, if I recall, Sisters of Battle, Necrons, Inquisitor?
It's Sisters with Inquisition, Necrons, Chaos. Necrons had the War of the Spider, I believe, was their book.
War? That's not the one I got.
I think that War of the Spider was the one with the, it was, Necrons was before that. Necrons already had a book to talk about. It's Chaos, Sisters, Eldar, stuff.
Oh, okay.
Inquisition stuff.
Mm, good.
But
for a second, I thought a second book had come out.
There is a Necron character coming out in it, so they might be a part of it.
Well, it's Fabius's bile. I thought
Fabius
was
in the book before this one, like the latest one that just came out.
Oh yeah, yeah. But yeah. I thought it was called War of the Spider.
Yeah, that was War of the Spider.
Yeah, I already have the Chaos book. Which one was that again? It was Phoenix Rising or something.
That was.
Not Battle of Ball.
That was still Sisters and all that.
Yeah, that was Battle. That's like something Faithful or something like that.
Faith and Fury.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that will transfer from our 9th edition talk. Excuse me, and we'll go right into D&D.
Dungeons and Dragons, the game for kings.
Yep. For those who don't know what D&D is or may be interested, because there is people out there, D&D is a role-playing game where a person sits at a table, just kind of like what we're doing now, and narrates a story to you, just like when you were a kid, when your parents would read you bedtime stories, except for instead of it being a priest-like story, you are the character in the book, and you get to dictate what that character does and interacts. So it's like playing a video game, but without needing electricity. And you can do some crazy things, there's different settings. D&D is just the big name one, so when a lot of people talk about RPGs, they say D&D in general.
Yeah.
Tabletop, role-playing games, Dungeons & Dragons is definitely the staple. Yep. Gary Gygax is a hero.
It's the OG.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, you can find other variants as well.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, there's endless variants, endless spin-offs, or different games, different companies.
Yeah. So everyone's been, like, kind of knows my game. But yeah, there's many... friends here sitting with us has played with us in the group for a bit. But yeah, what you two guys been playing? What's your kind of favorite editions?
I personally like 5e and Dungeons and Dragons a lot. I like the staple for a reason. Prefer the more swords and sorcery type stuff too, less the futuristic ones. Meh, they're good. I'm running a game right now, and it's very much fantasy.
I feel like fantasy feels more natural to a D&D setting than...
Exactly.
It aids the suspension of disbelief.
And in its name, Dungeons and Dragons, not futuristic rifles and flying cars.
How many dragons have you seen in Dungeons?
Very good question. I think the answer is very close to 0. I will have to rectify that in the campaign I am running.
For a game whose name is literally Dungeons and Dragons.
Okay, to be fair, I have been thinking about a dungeon I want to create that is a fossilized dragon. So the dungeon would be the dragon.
Mm-hmm. There you go, that's the loop around. The fire traps are just its actual fire on its elements.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah.
That would be sick.
The players were going to have to break through its fossilized skin and work its way through its anatomy, which is still intact and hollow.
Of course.
This is so, a bit of like a... I don't know, I was going to give them a biological map of a dragon and say, you figure it out from there.
That's the end goal of the campaign. I am the heretic, I guess, of the group. I love my cyberpunks and my sci-fis and all the weird things in between.
I like fantasized games.
So, I mean, it doesn't mean I like the occasional futuristic one.
Oh, yeah. And it's not like nobody likes them. One of my players very much used to play, like, a Star Wars.
Mm. The Star Wars role-playing game is really good.
Used to play that one. And he's, we were playing a one-off for, we're going to have a lot of time off. Everyone does. But we want to plan a one-off, and he suggested doing an Alien Isolation or Aliens...
Yes.
Themed role-playing game. I just don't know where to go.
My favorite one is Cthulhu, the one-shots.
Ooh, that would be fun. That would be a lot of fun.
So yeah, storytell. Yep. I remember years ago, I made a joke. This is when Ryan, Will, and I were still at our old place, Gamers Alley. So this is when I got first into it, of Pathfinder.
That was all you.
Thanks to you, by the way. Yeah, thanks for introducing me to that. So our friend Parker, or Maybe Man as we like to call him, at one day...
You always said maybe.
Maybe. Which always became a last minute no. Disgusting. Anyway, back to main story. I made a joke one day, because my brother and I had to pick him up from his house, which was like... 30 to 40 minute walk to and from the store. So we went to get him, and when we were picking him up, I was making a joke. Just imagine if your character died today, later in that day while I was playing a Warhammer game. All I just hear at the across the store, "Damn it, Glenn!" I look over, look, "What? You killed my character!" Oh shit, I was making a joke out of it. So what I did came to life, and it came true.
The jinx are very true. My players will often say offhanded subjects or topics, and I just can't help but smile, like right before the game begins. And they look at me and they're like, "Ah, crap.
Yeah, my players always don't give me ideas. Everyone knows me, I'm the Gauntlet Master.
Well, I had the entire session planned out. I wanted them to go down into these limestone caverns to try to navigate their way underneath an army of 300 goblins. Anyway, so this was my plan, and right before the session began, one of them was like, "Down in the darkness, we must rise to the light." He just said this, just being dramatic, I guess, and I just stare at him, and I start laughing. And he couldn't figure out why. And he was like, oh, he realized. Well, anyway, long story short. When they were trapped, a kilometer underground, being plagued by giant constrictor snakes and all that fun cave stuff. Oh, and Gelatinous Cube, a good classic threw in there. He just looked at me and was like, "God damn it, man."
Voldemort, do you have any questions?
Or any stories to tell?
None at the moment.
He is just enjoying the company.
Yeah. I remember another time in Pathfinder, same campaign as Parker's character died, but this was before Parker joined us. Will and I were being invaded by a giant zombie horde.
I want to run something like that.
Yeah. So, he was talking out of character, and I thought he was talking in character. So he said, I could make water and make money. In my mind thinking, "Will, we're in the middle of a zombie apocalypse right now. Now's not the best time." And he kept on saying, like, "No, but we could make money and all that." For like 2.5 to 3 minutes we were talking about this. And then all of a sudden, one of the players just like said, "Okay, you know what? Tyler," that was the DM's name, "Tyler, stop talking for a moment and take a listen to these two." Everybody stopped, looked at our direction while we were arguing about it. Last thing we said was like, "I was talking out of character," Will said. And I said, "Oh, wait, I thought you were talking in character." It broke our DM, Tyler, for 3 minutes. We got extra experience points out of this.
To bring this into a natural sort of segue about DMing, we have what, two DMs and two players at the table now?
Yeah, I'm a new DM to try my first campaign. It was meant to be like a one-off. I built one session, maybe two, and it's just evolved from there. But yeah.
I've been DMing forever. Like, I haven't really been a player. Except for until the one like campaign with Bryce as DM. And yeah, another friend of ours too. But about sticks are fighting back. Yeah. So I know a lot of players, especially why they go to adventure nights, not necessarily ours. But they go to those nights because they don't have DMs. As a new DM, what would you kind of say to people who are like, we need DMs, but I might not want to because I'm a player, like, they think it's too much and all that?
From my experience, players are typically very supportive, so you just roll with it. As long as you have a basic understanding of the game, no one's usually upset when you flip through a book to figure out something specific. And if you make a mistake, so what? It's part of the world. I made a fairly large, like a minor mistake, but it's like overcharged the party for something. And so I'm just rolling with it. Like, yeah, no, that guy just totally cheated them. That NPC, blame it on the NPCs. That's my one piece of advice. Anything goes wrong, it's the NPC's fault.
I am really mad for that, because I don't play... I'm going to say something here that's going to be very controversial, that no one has known for a while. It's not a huge big thing, but I don't know the 5th edition rules.
Oh! I actually didn't know that.
Me neither.
No, this is... So, when I buy an RPG, I buy it because it's wonky or weird, and it throws people off. Like, why the hell do you have that?
Exactly.
And it's... I'll flip through it to kind of get the general understanding. And, like, Wrath and Glory, the 4K one, I definitely had to read. That one was a book in itself. But I find for 5th edition, like, D&D, like, running store, like events, your players 90% of the time will just tell you the rule. And I've learned through my players. So they're like, I want to cast a spell. I'm like, okay, what does the spell do? And then they'll tell you.
So I'm trying to encourage that with my players, but sadly, they're all new at this, too. I'm the only one who's familiar with the rules, and one other is experienced in role-playing games, but between the two of us, it's...
I'd definitely say, like, it's a group thing. You don't need to know the rules. It is just a set of guidelines.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Rules are always guidelines. What you say goes. And when you're tweaking the rules, I would suggest being open with it. Like, that's fine.
I also don't use adventure books. Like, I use them for the setting. But, like, the longest one we had at my work, the 2-year one that started it all, was the starter box for 5th edition when it came out. But then we went to Rise of Tiamat, the Dragon Horde. We used the first 4 pages of that. No, it was, it started in, like, another one. Then went into Tiamat. We used the first 4 pages, and after that, it was all in my head.
Not bad.
There was no books behind my DM screen, just the laptop. To write notes and some dice.
So you just rolled with everything.
Yeah. Well, nice. My players were like, so, like, players are going to be 90% of your problems at the end. Especially if you have a group of friends, it's going to be so much easier. But in a place that's where you're always constantly swapping, the role play, I find the characters will guide themselves, and you're just there to say yes or no to a rules question.
On the other side of that, I found that I've had to drive my players' interest quite a bit. If you want the players to do all of the moving from location to location, all that, you just need to give them a really, really good hook. I have yet to find that hook for my players.
Yeah, or you just, another one is like, people don't want a railroad. If you want them to go to a room and they have to go there, but they miss it, just move the room ahead. Make them actually walk into it.
Oh, yeah, reusing resources, absolutely.
Like, you want them to fight in a tavern because they need to meet the NPC, but they skip it in the first town?
Yeah.
But in the second town.
Exactly. Yeah. If you built a sky temple to a dragon god that they're supposed to get teleported to and they don't, well, now it's the underground temple in that cavern system they randomly walked into anyway. Mm-hmm. So all you have to do is tweak aesthetics.
What do you two have?
I have another story. Yeah. This is when Rocky was around. We, most of us, except Ryan here, would remember. I think if I remember, Voldemort was just beginning to become friends with us, I believe.
Probably back in the early days.
Remember the fire? Oh, my head explodes because I remember my past self one.
Oh, yeah. How you guys?
Yes.
That failed in that past to save the universe from imploding.
So, this is where Walter Greyfist was first around. For you, the ones who don't know, Walter Greyfist was my first non-sorcerer or magic-wielding character. A ranger. Yeah. I was ranger, and, my first non-magic user. He died, like, 3 weeks after creation, sadly enough.
We burn character sheets when they die.
Yeah. And so far, and when that happened, the main creator of Pathfinder was like...
Oh, yeah, he drank till your character
he
died.
He literally raised his glass and posted it on the Facebook page to rip Walter Greyfist. Like, that's an honor to hear from you, sir.
When your death is recognized.
Yeah. No. Okay, so back to the main story. Walter Greyfist died, a new character was born. One of Will's NPC was a mute for a reason. And Rocky was like a fighter, like he always is.
That's how she communicated.
Oh.
So, we were...
Does she actually, like, carry around, like, a chalkboard?
Yeah.
Just right?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, she knew sign language, but for people who couldn't, she had a chalkboard that hanged off her belt and she would write symbols on it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Not advisable to new players, but... entertaining.
Okay. So, we were on the bridge of death. Rocky had to literally close up the portal. He managed to do 2 nat 1s and a nat 20. The nat 20 was the freebie. Because if it didn't, the game would have ended there.
Yeah, he needed that 20 or it would have just ended the game there.
Yeah.
Because they derailed it so far that I didn't know how to bring it back. Mm-hmm. He rolled the 20.
You want to talk nat 1s? So, in my party, one of the encounters I ran for them is I had the cave fisher spider attack them in a forest. It had created webs about 30 feet up, and that was its base of operation. It was almost invisible from ground level, that sort of thing. It was a neat, fun little encounter I planned. So, one of the players had decided, most of them made their way up there into the foliage, 30 feet up. It was almost like a second forest floor. And one of the players thought it would be a brilliant idea to get away from the spire by climbing higher. And I was like, oh, okay, sure. So he winds up about being 60 feet from ground level. 60 feet from ground level. And then he decides to make a plunging attack against the spider that was directly beneath him. And I just look at him, flabbergasted. I was like, okay. Acrobatics check. He rolls a nat 1. So he plunges straight past the spider, past the party, through the spider web, and plunges into the forest floor because, well, he just jumped off a tree and died. So I just have him sitting there making death saving throws. Oh, man.
So, back to my story. Rocky managed to close the portal, bringing us to an alternate universe. It was his character, his mind, inside of the mute's character. Surprisingly enough, the mute actually managed to talk, which was Rocky talking. Alternate universe, Rocky's mind and mute's character. And his mind was completely wiped. He never knew a single thing from his previous life and all that. So, this is when my second character was a magic user again, where Fireball. We went to a farm to hear a noise. Right near the end, I was just like, okay, screw it, we're in a tall grass, fireball the entire thing just to kill it. Nothing happened.
Except lighting the field on fire, I'm assuming.
Yep, and Rocky's character decided to follow right after for some reason.
It was a call.
Yeah.
So to put it in context, the reason why his body got switched over to the NPCs was because she was a sorcerer, and in my world, they switched her like sirens from Borderlands. So they're like a mystical being of the Force. So because his power, his body exploded from the bridging of the two worlds, it needed to go somewhere, and her body, she died at that point, so he took over her body. But in this universe, she didn't have the curse of being magical, and as she did in the other one, so she could speak. Okay. So he was a cop chasing after these magical beings that just teleported to the realm.
Yep. And right at the end, my character tried convincing him, like, okay, roll this. Oh, it didn't work. Roll this. Didn't work. Then, like, we were quiet for a second. All of a sudden, I remembered in real life, wait a second, the moment where we both lit up the fire in the bar. Like, oh, shit, yeah, you're right. So I was like, okay, let's do that. I rolled a nat 20. He rolled a nat 1. So we were all just sitting there all quiet while I was laughing my ass off. Like, yep, that'll do it. And his mind literally was blown, like, oh shit, this did happen. Wait a minute.
Wait, all the memories floated back.
Well, the dice are fickle. Yep. Fickle creatures.
It was hilarious as hell.
There's, at my table, there's one dice that's just floating around between all three players, and everyone's unanimously has had bad luck with it. I love it. That dice is never getting thrown away.
So talking about dice, another big thing about D&D that's very iconic is superstitions and dice. How you can never have enough dice. So we already heard Glenn's stories about dice. We know about the tale of Beowulf at Boiis's table and the void closet we shall never enter again. But what are some of your guys' superstitions, I say in air quotations, about dice?
I believe if you aren't loyal to your dice won't be loyal to you.
Voldemort?
You gotta pay proper tributes to the lowest of luck and probability.
Oh yeah, you're the cleric of the RNGesus.
Get a full Archibian for my Korra. Oh, God damn it.
Man. Yeah.
Yes. He's Voldemort.
The one true disciple. Favorite champion of the gods.
RNGesus. I like that.
Yeah.
Always lucky.
No. It's...
When they decide to favor me.
Permanently? Goodness.
No one wants to harm Voldemort.
Yeah.
Well, despite the name Voldemort.
Well, I mean, it's just a nickname.
It's just a nickname.
Mm-hmm.
The real Voldemort, yes, people want to hurt him badly. Voldemort, no one can do wrong to him.
It's just an accident of birth. His parents didn't know that the name Voldemort would go out of style. He who shall not be named wasn't a thing back then. Yep. So it's all...
Wasn't it just Tom Riddle?
Yeah.
When they switched her up?
No.
Where does the name come from?
Tom Riddle was his real name. Voldemort was...
It was Tom Riddle. I don't know where the V came from.
Maybe it was like middle initial?
It must have been. I don't know.
Anyway, back to D&D talk. We don't want to get sidetracked.
Really do. You never know where that goes.
Yeah, that's true.
Man, do you think a Harry Potter themed campaign would be fun?
That wouldn't be bad.
I kind of have that in my new game I'm running for the store. Where's, how I'm pulling from the anime Weeb train.
Anime Weeb train?
So you were in the campaign I was running at work for a while when we were still in the Death Australia.
Three or four sessions. Yeah. Death Australia. This is with the cultists and Tiamat. Yeah.
That was a long time. But so how we're doing it now is how I'm explaining magic being a thing and like how people are adventurers and leveling is there's like a Hogwarts of sorts that they go to, and every year, the black coaches, which, if you guys get that reference...
You're talking about the black ships?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
They go around the continents to the aligned cities, or the...
And they just pick up all the people that can make sparks with their fingertips.
Yeah. So that you, they pick up people based off of things, like, depends on the person who's leading that caravan. Mm-hmm. Some people like Marshall Prowlitz, some go, are you magically inclined, then you're instantly staying.
Oh, well... Okay. Sorry, continue, but I have a thought to go after this.
So, how I started this new campaign we're doing for the third age, I'm splitting them in ages like each Lord of the Rings, is they're trying to earn their rights to go to the coach, so they learn that the coaches are going to be at this major city during a festival. So they're doing different games, trying to act out, trying to get noticed by a senpai. And if they get noticed, or a gold tier adventurer notices them, they can be like, yeah, I trust this guy, get him into school. And it's kind of like Witcher. So they go to the school, they get Witcher's eyes, and only 3 out of the, like, 100 students that go there
survive?
Pass.
Oh, pass or survive. Both. Either or, got it.
Some will die, others will just not pass. But... And if they do pass, they become bronze adventurers. They get some legal protection and rights, like cops, like sheriffs.
Mm-hmm.
They get the ability to resurrect and level. But leveling isn't just like, oh, I marked a sheet. It's actually trained.
Okay, so you're going full, like, adventurer's guild type thing mixed with Hogwarts, mixed with Witcher. Very cool.
So that's how I explain leveling and, like, you gaining in power and magic and resurrection.
Alright.
And why you can kick someone's door down and be like, I'm here to take your bounty. And no one's going to be like, Link, stop breaking our bonds.
You're giving the universe a reason for adventurers to exist. Well... you were talking about a place for learning magic. Something popped up into my mind to do with the Dragon Prince animated series on Netflix. Like, I'm waiting. Season 4 we're waiting for?
Yeah. So good.
Yeah.
Highly recommend that
show. So, spoilers ahead from here on out. But at the end of Season 3, like, man, Callum can learn magic.
Yes.
He is...
The power was himself all along.
Mm-hmm. Well, he is more... Mm-hmm.
Have you seen number 3?
Yes.
Okay,
we're all
good. Okay. Sweet. I did say spoilers ahead on the video. But Voldemort is in the clear. So, the Storm Arcana, he has learned it with a unspoken potential of learning more, depending on people teach him. So for the new season, I'm wondering if they're going to go with him searching for people to teach, or if they're going to go with a much more political approach where he is going to travel back to the human realms and try to find humans to teach, to be like, yo... This is a bridge between, you know, people.
I hope he, like, just learns like he did with the air one, and kind of with the help of some elves.
The second he proves himself to the elves, I believe they will be much more likely to teach him. Unless it's, you know, you find some racist, bigoted elves.
I like the whole, like, he actually learned it himself. Oh, another protest.
Yeah, watching on the TV right now. More protests. A bunch of people lying belly first. Man. I don't think there's ever going to be a Dungeons & Dragons protest.
No.
They're all too contented. Yeah. Play Dungeons & Dragons, you become a contented person.
There was that one hot topic that happened last week. The racism in D&D.
I never heard
Are
about
you talking
that.
About, like,
how people are getting pissed off because drow and orcs and stuff are depicted as...
No way, really?
So, we won't go too deep into it. I feel like this is another topic for a time where we're not drinking and can be at home. But from what I can remember, what happened was D&D, Wizards of the Coast made a post recently about the Black Lives Matter, because everyone's trying to sell on it. Companies are trying to sell on it. But
or they're afraid that if they don't appear to have a side, they will be shot at by both.
So what they're doing is...
Figuratively, of course.
Or literally, depending on where you are.
True enough.
So what they're doing is they're making an FAQ for the core rulebook, which is basically removing a lot of, air quotes again, racism of the different races in the book. And they're changing it up, so not all these races are necessarily evil. So drow, orcs. I always say you leave it up to your group. You know what your group wants.
Yeah.
Well, that is the golden rule.
Yeah. Just my only problem with anything is don't change something so drastic that it gets rid of originality. But also, like, not don't change. Like... D&D has naturally went from just being orcs super evil in first edition 2. There's a bunch of stories of orcs like making kingdoms and joining up with humans and like naturally progressing to be separate. Orcrock.
Yes, and those are the themes that should be there. That's why I think all of these themes should never go away, is because it's the exceptions that you find in the narratives that you can draw lessons from. Or at least meaning.
Yeah. Yeah, that was basically just the update of it.
Yeah.
That happened on that. What?
Ew.
How do you see
that?
A fighter?
He kind of reminds me of my stepbrother up north. I don't know why, he reminds me of my stepbrother up north. That's gross.
Well, yeah, any last closing statements here before we end the cast?
No. Never be afraid to DM.
Burn the dice in front of the dice. If they don't believe...
So well, that is true. Dice. I have burnt dice as well. For a friend, I wear my dice.
For a friend.
For a friend.
It's the truth.
I guess then we'll go into what any rants you guys want to talk about for D&D. or any role-playing games.
Rants?
Any rants. Anything you don't like.
Oh. You know what? I don't know. There's always going to be things I don't like, but they're very personal. They aren't a problem with the game system.
Oh, yeah. The song that hey. People were singing.
right?
But, no, I can go rants. I don't like 5th edition.
You don't like 5th edition?
Interesting.
I don't have anything wrong with it.
To be fair, I will say I don't like it as a long-time player. I like it as a beginner player. I find it's the stepping stone to get into the role-playing universe.
Alright.
But, I just find it's too watered down. It favors decks. Like, being wizards and stuff used to be rare and, like, a role-playing experience. Now it's just like, fingers go...
I guess it's kind of true.
Yeah. No, yeah. Like,
there's no purpose in being a strength user. Rogue is... I guess rogue. Rogue is very busted. Because a lot of people... And this is going off your player going straight from the book and not roleplaying. If you have a group that really wants to roleplay, especially if a DM, like, say, again, a big popular example, like Matt Mercer, their group, they're very roleplay heavy. He goes off very
completely,
little rules.
Completely roleplay heavy.
In that, 5th edition is perfect. But in a setting where you're in a, like, an Adventurer's League where it's all players and universalized rules, it is very rules lawyering. It sucks because there's no creativity in it.
I dislike rules lawyers, but at the same time, I know how to deal with them. You drop them out of trees.
Like that natural one guy in Spiders?
Yeah, he's a guy that plays the game his way, and I just have the obvious consequences happen.
I don't let my players slide consequences like getting fried in a room. Eric!
Oh, well, they...
No shade, Eric. I love you, buddy. You make the games fun. But...
Eric.
You didn't check for the door. There was a door in the hallway you didn't get past. I'll tell you guys later about that one.
There was... my party actually killed a kobold guide I had given them. And a kobold was, after being eaten by a gelatinous cube, ran from the encounter. Like, they rescued him. He was there. They revived him with 1 point of HP. That's all the paladin was willing to give him, which is all he needs, really. But the thing woke up and said, oh god, we're all gonna die, and ran. And then the paladin was like, I don't like acts of cowardice, and chopped him in half. And I'm just sitting there thinking like, oh, okay then.
You were gonna say something about it.
I don't know.
I don't think I have any flaws whatsoever in any D&D game.
To be fair, you've also just been a player, which it's not against your opinion.
No,
saying that you've just been a player, because a lot of people are just players when they play.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't see a lot of the background stuff, which is good. That means that the game's doing what it's supposed to.
Yeah.
You as a player don't really have to really touch the book. You know, that means you have a really good DM. It doesn't mean they know everything. It means they just want you to have good experience, or the game is just really simple.
I'm trying to get my players to learn their own classes enough so that, like, because I don't know their stuff, I intentionally don't memorize their abilities. I ask them what their abilities do, and they have to flip through the book every time, but eventually, they'll remember.
That's like a Bryce's game with the other group of players, when you were the guy who went homeless because a Tarrasque broke your house. Oh my god, that's another story I have to tell you guys, too. That was great.
What a... Forget about the one where it's like, hey, Rogue, what are you doing? I see a shiny.
Yeah, that's another one we have to talk about. The bad don't touch closet.
Oh.
The conqueror's closet.
Oh, no. Not there.
I saw a gem at the middle of the door. I was playing as the Rogue. I was role-playing as the Rogue.
Yeah, so you role-played as the Rogue to go try to steal the gem.
Yes.
But then you somehow failed to do that, even after you had the gem literally handed to you by a apparition of yourself.
There were two separate gems. The gem that was holding the door.
Oh, yes.
This is the gem from the alternate.
A long story short, you made it out of that near, like, we almost got, like, party wiped, except for one guy who just wasn't there that night.
That was Voldemort.
Yeah, Voldemort wasn't there, so he would have survived, and we didn't get anything to show for it.
My character was broken.
Yeah,
Bryce likes to break my characters for some stupid reason.
Yeah, no, for some reason, no, to that story, I was going to give in a ruby gem,
and an invisibility cloak.
Well, I almost got a tome of everything that ever was. I was very excited for that, and we almost got it too.
Not a dead body. Actually, we got a book.
Yes, yeah, but
not the one he wanted. Not the one he wanted.
We almost got it. As long as we had kept trying with that crossbow, we could have harpooned the thing. I may have not made out of, like, one word on each page.
Hey, my bolts are worth money.
We tied a rope to it. You got your bolt back.
Yeah, well, if you shoot the special bolts I have, they can't be put back.
So like the poke.
No, that was a really fun puzzle we had to go through. Oh, man.
A lot of emotions, a lot of good roleplay.
A lot of fears. We're about to release a cosmic entity that will turn all of the truths in the world to lies and kill everything.
It was like I wanted the gem.
Yeah.
I wanted the gem. I saw a gem and I went
but
for it.
That, if you guys don't have anything else to add, and we can talk about later, having definitely enjoyed having you guys on our cast tonight. It was fun catching up. I know we've been kind of away because of the whole virus.
Yeah.
Again,
social interactions.
Go around the table, starting from my left. Again, we'll say what we had tonight. Final opinions. Would you recommend it on a scale between 1 to 10 compared to other places you've had?
Right.
So, well, for an example, we'll start with Glenn.
The nachos. I always go for the nachos. I always get the nachos at 10. The Parkati.
Yeah, it's true. We went to the
Canadian brew house,
and he said 10 for the nachos too. Except for he liked those ones slightly better than these ones.
So what do you say? Those were 10.1.
Oh yeah,
10.5. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So back to the nachos to 10. I would go for them. In the Bacardi, I would have to say 5 this time instead of like 10, like I did with the Jaeger last week or 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm.
Voldemort?
Mozzarella sticks. Can't go wrong with mozzarella sticks.
Out of 10?
I mean...
It's a mozzarella stick 10, out of 10.
Yeah.
How many was in my bowl out of 10?
There. The true answer.
Yeah.
I always get the burger. I always get the burger that I think is going to be the most tasty on the menu. And this one, you know what? It was a good burger, but the poutine was better. So... I'm not going to give it an arbitrary rating, but I think the Canadian Brew House.
I will agree with Voldemort. I had the mozza sticks, and they were, yeah, I'll agree with him on that. They were, mozza sticks can't go wrong.
And all Muggles should die, I mean, I'm sorry.
Okay, Muggle lives matter.
Muggle lives matter.
Mozzakai on the other hand.
But,
it feels like all a dating reference.
Two out of the four had drink. It's where it even matched. Two is drinking, two is not.
Well, drinking alcoholic drinks, and the other two are drinking, but non-alcoholic
drinks. Two have drinks, two have soft drinks. Or softer drinks.
Yeah.
So with that, I'm going to tell everyone to load up on the Get Out of the Bar say we're on our way. So this has been A Nerd and a Weeb. I'm going to be your designated driver, Will.
I'm your designated drinker, Glenn.
And our special guests, Ryan and Goldmark. We shall see you guys, probably maybe with some new guys, in our next spot. Again, leave comments down below what drinks Glenn should try next. I know we already had one I saw on the Discord, which I forgot to bring today. Ooh. I'm a sorry person. We'll try it for next time. But yeah, it was an interesting shot. It was like a combination of two things I've never seen before.
Did it have a name?
I think so.
Does it literally have a split in the middle too? Oh, if they do, I want to try that.
But anyways, with that, we shall see you guys in the next podcast. But yeah, leave a like down below, leave drinks. We shall see you later.
And bye. Thanks for our great.